developing our new policy in this area is our wonderful spokesman, Stuart Adams.
Right, thank you very much. Because Roger Helmer went over, I'm very happy to sacrifice some time because I really do admire Roger and I could have clapped every single word he said. Now, I'm going to give you a quick update as to where we are with the agriculture. Shortly after I was asked to do it, I was asked to do a little bit more, apart from the core policy of agriculture, which we haven't started yet. I will be asking for the help of Lord Willoughby de Brooke, Tony Brown, Will Shaw, and if we have a large animal vet in the party, please come and speak to me. Fishing, that's been added on. This was done by Bob Goss, who is a member in North Devon. He is now fighting for his very life against a wind farm off the North Devon coast, and he hasn't got time to talk about fishing. So what I've done is I've asked Stuart Gulliford, who works with me in my office, who worked with my predecessor, Geoffrey Titford, for several years, and Geoffrey was very, very into the whole fisheries problem. Stuart knows several fishermen now very well. All right, we're on the East Coast, but we will use their expertise, a couple of other consultees to produce the fishing policy. Coastal Defence, we have done a paper on this, but it hasn't as yet gone to the NEC. So I'm just going to do a very, very one-shot summary of that. What we have presented to the NEC, and it has been passed by the NEC, is the Wildlife and Forestry Policy. Now, on Coastal Defence, we have about 3,300 miles at risk, including a lot of my own coastline in the east of England. That's about 17% of the total. Now, we have looked at this in very great detail, and if we spend either between £350 million to £880 million a year for 30 years, we will crack this problem. We will crack this problem. The variance depends upon the type of structure needed, the certain piece of coastline. We tend to start from the worst and work outwards. Now, you look at those figures and you think that's per year. We're putting £50 million a day into this European Union. Surely this is a much better investment. But why haven't we done it? Why just haven't we got on with it? Well, the answer lies, of course, in the EU. When we signed the Maastricht Treaty, we gave them the power to say how much money we could spend on capital public projects. We got around some of this with PFI, but that's not really appropriate to coastal defence. Once you build coastal defences, you inevitably change the environment behind them. The European Union is in charge of the environment in this country, so you've got to go grovelling to them for their permission. But actually, overarching all of this has been an attitude. Roger talked about it, the attitude that the sea level is going to rise by 1 metre, 5 metres, 10 metres, and I can remember going to a conference in Norfolk where they showed the effect on our coastline of all these rises. Well, we know that isn't going to happen. We know it might rise a few inches in 100 years, but the fact that this hysteria has been around has created the attitude, oh, we don't bother with that, there's no way we can keep that lot out. Actually, it's not such a big problem, and we ought to be protecting our coastline. There are a lot of people living in this country, a lot of people living in great fear near these broken down coastlines, to say nothing of the fact that our very best farmland is in these positions. Now, the policy that we presented to the NEC and was accepted by them on the wildlife and forestry, the whole strapline here, or the ethos of the whole thing, is striving for balance. Our rural environment, our ecosystems, have got seriously out of balance. And not many people are aware of what is going on. We want to get things back into balance. And in no particular order, the first thing we want to do, I'll just get this light out, you may not be able to see what, can you see what's under that bird's foot? Yeah. That's a songbird. Now, we have got two charities in this country. We've got the RSPB, and we've got the Songbird Survival Trust. The RSPB say, hands off those. They can do no wrong. You must not touch them. They are protected forever. The Songbird Survival Trust say, hang on a minute. Those numbers of these are going up and up and up. They're eating these, and their numbers are going down and down and down. Who's right? Who is right? So what we want to do in UKIP is instigate a government-funded scientific study into the relationship between raptors and their prey. If their conclusion, and we don't know what their conclusion is going to be, but if their conclusion is that these numbers have to be controlled to protect protect these, then we will amend the 1981 Countryside and Wildlife Act in order to get that done. We've got a huge problem with bees in this country. Many of you may have tried to keep bees and just found that they die. We know that one of the problems is this Varroa mite. There he is there. And that's him sitting on the bee there. And they sit on the bee at just the place where the bee can't get its claws or tentacles to get rid of it. It sits there and sucks away the bee's nutrients. We would like to try and eradicate this mite, but we need research into that. We will instigate that. But also generally, a scientific study into bee decline, because it's not all about the Varroa mite. All right, we are a libertarian party, and the word up there is ban. But there, sometimes you have to ban something. We have people walking into garden centres demanding invasive plant species. They want to use Redendron ponticum as a rootstock, with no idea of the problems that would bring on further down the line. So I'm sorry, there is going to have to be a ban, because people don't really understand what they're doing when they ask for these things. You may or may not be aware that there is actually a deer culling policy in progress at the moment. Deers are naturally a part of the country. They are able to multiply very, very quickly, and those who know about it and who are in charge of the policy attempt to keep some sort of a balance. There is that word again, balance. We're quite happy with the sentiment of the policy, but we would like to see it managed better. There's examples of damage. The deer, it's not just forestry. When they get into large herds, they do serious trampling damage to farm crops. And of course, the more there are, the greater the statistical likelihood is they will jump in front of a car at night and everybody gets killed. Now, this is the core of the thing. This is what our chairman meant when he said grasping the nettle. During the last 50 years, a number of species have arrived in this country. They never would normally have developed here. They have been brought in because somebody thought they looked nice. There's been no organisation to it. No permission has been given. It's just happened. Well, there's a few of them, and we are going to eradicate them, pure and simple. And top of the list is this thing, the grey squirrel or the tree rat. See here? That's got two birds' eggs in its mouth. Now, 2 years ago or so, you may remember, DEFRA proposed to sell off the old ancient forests into the private sector. And there was mayhem. Everybody who thought his important opinion, and that his opinion was important, and that's a lot of people, rushed to the microphone to say how terrible this was, the sale of our forests. And the Today programme got involved, Question Time, any questions, any newspaper columnist worth his salt had to have all these commentaries about it. What that said to me was at least that the opinion formers in this country do appreciate and value our trees. Their conclusion, or their rather naive belief that all you had to do was have them in public ownership, I'm afraid was a bit wide of the mark, because over the last 50 years we have been seeing a massive assault on our trees, be it ancient forests, hedgerow trees, anything you like. If it's a tree, it's got a problem because of the squirrel. Now, if you take an ancient forest, it's been there 2,000 years, the trees you see there today, of course, are not the trees you saw 2,000 years ago if you were there. There's been a process of natural regeneration that goes on. The squirrel is preventing, stopping natural regeneration. That starts at about this time of year with the fall of seeds and acorns, in huge numbers, safety in numbers. Many of those acorns provide food for all sorts of species throughout the winter. And there's a lot lost there, but that's nature and that's the balance. Quite a lot become seedlings, and those seedlings are then ravaged by grazing animals, but some of those still survive to become young trees. And those that do look around at one another and say, cool, we've done it, chaps. We are the trees of the future. We're going to be here in 150 years' time. And then a grey squirrel drops on its back. It's big enough to support the weight, and the grey squirrel strips the bark. Now, some of you might say, oh, well, strip a bit of bark. You know, it's like losing my fingernail off my finger. It's a bit of protection. It's a bit uncomfortable if you lose it. It'll grow back again. Stop making such a silly fuss. It's not worth eradicating the species for a bit of bark. This is a fingernail that's actually a bit more than a fingernail bark at a tree. This contains the blood, the arteries, the heart, the spleen of the tree between the bark and the tree itself. Along the leaves, this contains the breathing apparatus of the tree, the lungs, the trachea, the alveoli. It also contains the digestive parts, organs of the tree. You take that off a tree and it's a very traumatic experience for it. It tries to recover, it slows up its growth. It may be able to withstand the first attack. More squirrels jump on, aren't they nice fluffy things? So what happens? That tree will not become a good forest tree. It will become a miserable stunted bush, or it will die. Now, I hope that all those people who rushed the microphones 2 years ago in defense of trees will not back away from eradicating this squirrel, because that's doing far more damage to these trees than the private sector ever would. And if any of them start doing that, I will regard them as nothing more than strutting and posturing opportunists, and when their time comes, don't any of them dare ask for a wooded coffin. Now this doesn't stop with trees. We had a charming little mammal in this country. It was in every wood, in every county in England and Wales, and it's going. It's being forced out by the grey squirrel, its competitor. This is two-thirds of the size of the grey squirrel. It simply cannot compete with the grey squirrel for food. Added to that, this red squirrel suffers fatally from something called squirrel pox, which the grey squirrel carries but does not suffer. So when the two meet, it is like spears against machine guns. This loses all the time. So it's now been forced pretty well out of the entire English and Welsh mainland, and it's going back all the time. What we want to do is, once we've eradicated these greys, UKIP want to then get the red squirrel back across the whole of the English and Welsh mainland where it should be. That is our objective. But this tree rat doesn't stop at trees or squirrels. Here are three species of birds. All of these are on the way down quite rapidly because the squirrel eats their eggs. Once he's knocked those out, he'll then go down to the next lot on the list. I hope that the man who introduced this grey squirrel, because it looked nice and fluffy in his garden, will turn in his grave when he sees the problems that this has caused. So, how are we going to do the eradication? Yes, eradication is not new. We tried it on coypus 50 years ago and we succeeded. We tried it on grey squirrels 40 years ago and we didn't succeed. We've got to try harder. We want to fund scientific research into grey squirrel eradication by biological means. If they give us a few choices, we will go for the most humane way possible. We don't know if this can be done. We are going to try, because if we do nothing about this pest, our countryside is going to look very, very bleak indeed. Okay, that's enough for squirrels. This thing, this North American mink, is chewing, crunching, munching its way through our wildlife every day of the year. There's nothing that's going to get it. We've got to do something about it. Aquatic plants, floating pennywort and water primrose, they must be given the same status as ragwort. They have got to go. They are ruining our countryside. And of course, they prevent other species from getting going. They just dominate. Talk about balance, think about balance all the time. We have got to get it back. We're just ending up with a handful of unpleasant species. Terrestrial plants, I talked about Rhododendron ponticum earlier on. These are some people doing the right thing and setting it alight. Most of you will have heard of Japanese knotweed because it's affecting property values. It can more than halve the value of a property once it gets established there. It's not, we know how to do it, but we've got to do it. That's really the message. And there's one invertebrate, this unpleasant thing here. This is eating our flora and fauna. And of course, they're not expecting this. This is upsetting the balance. They can't come back fast enough, and so slowly we lose it. In forestry, we want to encourage the move away. We want to encourage the move away from monoculture. That is slowly happening. There's nothing worse, actually, than having trees all the same age. You need multi-age forests. That's what you need. We want to encourage production of large dimension, top quality timber. Well, get rid of the grey squirrels and you stand a chance of doing that. Proper and adequate funding for forest research scientists, tree diseases. We've seen Dutch elm ravaged our countryside. We've seen sod, southern oak disease, and there'll be more coming around. Our country is a wonderful climate for growing trees. If we put the same effort into researching tree diseases as we do crop diseases, we would have some very, very good forestry indeed. Proper adequate government funding for research into species selection and sustain a sustainable silviculture. If you can say that without stuttering, you've done damn well. Now, what's this going to cost? What is this going to cost? Well, we're going to raid the climate change budget in Jeffrey to do it. That is the biggest. Waste of money there ever was. I urge you to back these policies because if we implement them, we are going to wipe 50 years of damage off the slate and bring back a British countryside that is worthy of the name. Thank you very much. Well,